Security teams, listen up. Don't say no, say how. Because when you say no, your users say how, and you are not going to like their answer. Look, I get it. I'm a security guy myself. I know how risky new tech can be, but I believe it's better to get out in front of this stuff rather than stick your head in the sand to pretend that when you say no, that's what actually happens, because it isn't. When you say no, you just drive the behavior underground where you can't monitor or control it. You're essentially out of the loop at that point. It's a lot better to get on board the train and have a say in where it's going than to stand in front of it and just yell stop. Another way to look at it is through this analogy that I've used on some other videos. Why do you put brakes on a car? So you can stop? No. So you can go really fast. Don't believe me? How fast would you go in a car that had no brakes or that had really bad brakes? In fact, it turns out the fastest cars in the world have the best brakes. They have to, or otherwise they just crash into the wall. So that's the way security should be done. It should be an enabler. It allows the organization to take calculated risk and do things that they otherwise wouldn't be able to do. It shouldn't be like a parking brake that's just on all the time and saying no all the time. That becomes an inhibitor to the business. And if you remain an inhibitor to the business will go around you. So it's better to be the brakes on the high-performance car so that you are part of the solution and not part of the problem. Those who fail to learn from history are destined to repeat it. So what happens? What does history tell us happens when the security department becomes the department of no, where they just, for everything that you come up with, they give you a reason why you can't do that? Well, what happens is the user says how. Let me give you some examples of how users said how when the security department says no. And you're not going to like these answers if you're in security. So let's start with something that we're still dealing with today, but this one has been historically an issue for quite some time. Bring your own device. So an employee has at home, let's say a desktop system, a laptop, something like that, and they decide they're just going to either bring that into the office and connect in, or maybe they're on a trip, maybe they're on vacation, they still want to get some work done, so they're going to use that, or they've just got it at home and want to access some files from the office. So they just go ahead and do this. And how would they do it? Well, they could use some remote control software to connect into the corporate network, and now you've got a system which is not secured. In other words, the kids may be playing games on this thing as well, and it's got viruses and all kinds of other stuff running on it, and now it's got access into the system. So that's what happens if the company says, your system is too insecure, just don't connect, don't use your system, do not bring your own device, we don't allow that. Well, the employee just figures out how to do it and does it anyway. Now you end up with an insecure system on your network anyway. So I say when it comes to BYOD, there are really only two types of organizations. Those who have a good BYOD program where they have known which devices are coming in and they've put in the security controls in place, and those who haven't. But there's not a third group that doesn't have BYOD. You might outlaw it, but your employees figured out the how, and you've got to bring your own device in your environment. Another example, and this one goes back a little further to when we first started getting mobile phones, a lot of companies would say, mobile devices are not secure enough for you to have your corporate email downloaded into this thing. So we are not going to allow that. Not secure enough. Again, the security department said no. How does the user say how? Well, you're not going to like this answer either. Because what they decided to do in some of these cases is say, okay, if you won't let me download my corporate email to my phone, which is where it's really convenient for me to access it when I'm in between meetings and stuff like that, well, then I'll tell you what I'll do. I will forward from the corporate email server over to a public email server. Use your favorite personal email server as an example here. And then from there, I'll be able to download to here. So now what you've done, again, in this case, instead of providing a how mechanism that would have allowed the corporate email to come down to this device and allow it, instead, the user went with taking the sensitive information, putting it into a public server, which we have no control and visibility over, and now they're getting it down here anyway. Again, the organization said no, the user figured out how, and this is much worse than what it would have been if we had crafted a solution for them in the first place. Let's take a look at another example. How about bring your own wireless? Well, we take wireless access pretty much for granted these days because it feels like everywhere we go, we can go into a building and we just expect there to be a Wi-Fi hotspot. Well, it hasn't always been the case. In the early days of wireless technology coming out, a lot of companies didn't deploy it. Why would they not deploy it? Well, their view of it was, we're going to take all these workstations that we have and we're going to put them on a LAN of some sort, a local area network, and we're going to connect all these things up in a hardwired situation where with that, now I can't have a situation where someone is sitting out in the parking lot and sniffing our network traffic, because that's a risk with wireless. Wireless goes through the air, so it's not bounded just to the building itself, unless you've got some sort of shielding in the building, and most people don't have that. So companies looked at wireless and said, these wireless access points, those are too risky. We are not providing wireless access. So again, the security department said no. What did the user say? How? I know how to do that. I can go to my local electronics, computer store, whatever. I can buy one of these relatively cheap access points, and that will give me wireless access. And now we have an unsecured access point that has direct connection into our network. And they just run it off a port that's sitting right there in their office. So again, the organization, the security department said no. The user said how. The user now puts out an insecure version of this. What would have been better, again, is if the organization had said, you know what, we'll give you a secured wireless hotspot, and we'll use the right kind of cryptography and all of those kinds of things to make sure that this is a protected connection. Saying no led to a worse situation with the how. Let's go back even further in the Wayback Machine, and I remember these days, bring your own internet. The internet was not ubiquitous and everyone had it all the time. That has not always been the case. In the early days of the internet, if you wanted to get access, a company might say, okay, this is your workstation right here, and you have access to our internal network. So that is intranet. And we'll give you that level of access. That was not uncommon. But here's this big, bad, scary, external internet. And in this case, companies said, hey, we don't know what's out there. You shouldn't be on there. Just stay away from it. Well, so in saying no, guess what? The user said how. How might they do that? Well, these devices here, if that was a laptop, back in those days, if you wanted to access systems while you were traveling and things like that, they would have a modem port in there. So there was a modem built into it. You could plug it into an analog line in your hotel room or whatever, and then dial out. So what if somebody just did that with the analog line that might still be in their office in those days? Not so common now, but it was then. So then what happens is a user is connected to the internal network and simultaneously to the external internet that we were trying to avoid because we thought it was too risky. Now this workstation has essentially become a router between the two. So the company didn't want that to happen for sure. That's a worst case scenario. What they should have done is instead of saying no, they should have said how. And the way they could say how is to say, we're going to put the right controls on your system, and some companies would put maybe a proxy server you had to log in through, or we're going to put a firewall here that's going to do other types of mitigation. We'll put intrusion detection systems. We'll do the kind of monitoring that's necessary and educate the users so that they can go on the internet and be safe. We take all that stuff for granted now, but initially, security departments said no to bring your own device, no to bring your own wireless, no to bring your own internet. And now, eventually, those have become the norm because every one of these things, the user figured out how, and it resulted in a massive failure. Okay, now let's move a little closer to the current times and things that we're dealing with really on a regular basis. Next version of Turn of This Crank was essentially bring your own cloud, where now I can basically say, you know, there are cloud providers that are out there. It's not expensive. There are apps that are out here in this space. There are file sharing services out here in this space. If I want to send you a really big file and I don't want to send it through email because I want to maybe share it with lots of people, well, then I just upload this to a file sharing system in the cloud, and then all the people that come along that I want to have access to it can get it, along with all the people maybe that I didn't intend to have access will also be able to come and get it. So that's a big risk. Again, when the cloud first came out, what did organizations, security departments say? Don't use that. No, because we don't control all of this. This thing is risky, and I don't know what's going to happen with it. So if we don't provide users a method to do file sharing, then they're just going to figure out how to do it, and they're going to use the cloud anyway. Because you can outlaw it, but that doesn't make it stop happening. If people have mobile devices, then it doesn't matter what rules you're putting in your firewall, that's not stopping those mobile devices from getting out. So people went ahead and used these things anyway. What would have been a better solution in this case? Instead of saying no, say, you know what? We actually have contracted with this other cloud provider where we have vetted their security, and they have a file sharing app, and we want everybody to use this one. Or if there's another particular app that we think our employees are going to use, have them use the approved, authorized version, and have them avoid this version that hasn't been. That's an example of saying how, not just saying no. Now, if we move this into the future a little more to where we are right now, the big thing is bring your own AI. And I've worked with companies that say, you know what, those public chatbots, we know that they leak data because when you tell them the information, that information then can be used to train their models, and all kinds of bad stuff can happen from this, potentially. So we're going to outlaw that. You cannot use these AI systems that are sitting around out here. It's just too risky for you to be doing this kind of stuff. So we'll say no to that. Well, again, you can block it at the firewall. I've got a mobile device. I'll just access it from that. So saying no drives the behavior below ground where the security department now has no control. What would be a better option in this case? The better option would be to say, you know what, we're going to pick an AI provider and we're going to use their service because we vetted what the security is of it. Better still, we're going to build our own in-house version of this. Now, when I say build, that doesn't mean you have to go out and do all the model development and design and tuning and all that kind of business, but you could use a platform from a cloud provider and run it on your own private instance, either in your environment on-premise or in a private tenant in a cloud system that you have vetted the security on. And then tell your employees, do not use this one, use this one. Now they have an option. You have said how and not only said no. According to the 2025 IBM Cost of a Data Breach report, the average cost of a data breach in the US was greater than $10 million. That's a big chunk of change. And if shadow AI was involved, what's shadow AI? Well, that basically means the user went ahead and created their own AI. They downloaded their own models, they ran it in a cloud instance, and then maybe put in some of your data. Shadow AI increased the cost of a data breach more than $670,000. So these are the things that are costing companies real money, and driving AI behaviors below ground actually ends up costing you more because now you have the shadows to deal with. So all of that stuff just adds salt to the self-inflicted wound of saying no. So let's take a look at how you can say how without giving away the whole store in the process. So some of the things that you can do, start off by assessing the risk. Understand what it is that we're actually facing here, rather than just fear and superstition, fear, uncertainty, and doubt, that kind of thing, that big scary internet, that terrible AI, those infected devices that users have in their homes. Go understand what's actually there. And consider in the risk calculation the alternatives. If we don't provide them something, then they will find their own way. And even though you thought that internet was scary back in the day, it's a lot scarier if users end up making your system into a router that's connecting your network in ways that you didn't. So assess the full picture of the risk. And a lot of organizations tend not to do that. Then look for alternatives. See, are there ways that we can do it? Maybe we don't want you to use that particular AI because there are too many risks with it, but here's another one that you can use instead. Maybe we don't want you doing file sharing just in general because now we have a problem with shadow data. Data that's sitting around in all sorts of places that we have no visibility and no control over, and therefore it's not encrypted, it's potentially leaking out to the world. Find alternatives. Don't use this file sharing service, use this one that we've approved. Don't use this AI, use this one that we built for you or one that we have contracted with and we understand and know that it will do what we intend it to do. Another thing we can do is train our users. Make sure they understand what the risks are, because in many cases they don't. They just look at the bright, shiny object of the new technology and say, isn't this cool? Let me do that. Well, they need to understand that in some cases, what they're doing is putting not only the company at risk, but downstream, their jobs at risk. So this is existential threats for everyone involved. And then we need to do discovery. We need to discover all the cases where we may have shadow AI, where we have shadow data, where we have people that are bringing their own devices that have not been secured. We've got to do a good job of making sure we understand what the full threat space looks like. So ultimately, by doing this kind of stuff, you get out in front of the risk and keep everything above board where you can monitor and control it. In other words, don't say no, say how, every chance you get.